Good morning, everyone. It's Dan Milner from ASCP. Thank you again for joining us for, I believe it's day four of our Pathologists Overseas ASCP Laboratory Quality Management Systems course, exclusively for our African colleagues. Today's topic is process control on the qualitative quality control side. We heard from quantitative last time. This will be presented by Dr. Roa Harb. For your information, please remember, use the chat box down at the bottom to the left of your screen for technical problems or issues. Remember, these are being recorded and are available almost as soon as the session is over for your viewing and review. And then at the bottom left-hand side of your screen, there's a Q&A button. Please use the Q&A button to ask questions for Dr. Harb. If we can answer those questions in the background, we will, but most of them will be answered live at the end of her lecture before we start the cases, and then she will do her case review, and then she will take questions again. This should not take the full 2 hours today, but we do want everyone to be able to have a chance to ask questions. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Harb and let her introduce herself. Go ahead, Dr. Harb.
Thank you, Dan. Good afternoon and good evening, everyone. A brief introduction. I'm a clinical pathologist by training, and my area of subspecialty is clinical chemistry. I'm a medical officer at the Department of Laboratory Medicine at the National Institutes of Health, where I oversee the automated chemistry lab. I'm also a volunteer member at Pathologists Overseas, and my area of focus is the External Quality Assurance Program. I'm speaking to you today from Bethesda in Maryland. So in this module, we will continue the discussion on process control, this time as applied to qualitative and semi-quantitative testing. In this lecture, we will review general concepts of qualitative and semi-quantitative testing, go over built-in versus traditional controls, go over the utilization of stock cultures in microbiology QC, some QC procedures for stains, and QC for verifying the performance of microbiological media. Throughout this presentation, we will also investigate the following scenario, which will have four questions. I will give us 1 minute after each question for you to think about. Feel free to share your answers, but you don't have to. We will go over the answers as we move along. And this scenario represents a specific application of qualitative QC concepts and procedures in the clinical lab. So in this scenario, your lab performed testing on 20 patient samples for hepatitis B core antibody. QC included in the run had a new lot number. All of the patient samples and the positive QC were negative for the hepatitis B core antibody. The first question, how can you determine if the error is in the test system or in the new lot QC? So I'll give us 1 minute. Okay, before we dive deeper, it's good to keep in mind that QC is a component of process control, which is a major element of the quality management system. It monitors the processes related to the examination phase of testing and allows for detecting errors in the testing system. Errors detected by QC include test system failure, adverse environmental conditions, or operator performance. QC would give the lab the confidence that patient test results are accurate and reliable. This module will go over how QC methods are applied to the qualitative and semi-quantitative lab testing. So what are qualitative tests? Qualitative tests are those that measure the presence or absence of a substance or evaluate cellular characteristics such as morphology. The results are not expressed in numerical terms, but rather in descriptive or qualitative terms. For example, positive, negative, reactive, non-reactive. Examples of qualitative testing include microscopic examinations for cell morphology or presence of parasitic organisms, some serologic procedures for the presence or absence of antigens and antibodies, some microbiological procedures, and some molecular techniques. Semi-quantitative tests are similar to qualitative tests in that there is no precise measurement of quantity. However, they are different in that the results are expressed as an estimate of quantity. In other words, we're not simply interested in the presence or absence of a specific substance, but also in an estimate of its quantity. Therefore, test results are reported, for example, as trace amounts, 1+, 2+, 3+, or sometimes in terms of titers and dilutions, such as positive at 1 to 16. Examples of semi-quantitative tests are urine dipsticks for protein and ketones, some serological agglutination procedures, and even some microscopic examinations that we've termed qualitative. For example, a urine microscopic examination might report 0 to 5 red blood cells seen per high power field. Okay, back to our scenario. How can we determine if the error is in the test system or the new lot QC? So one way to do this is we would prepare a fresh batch of QC from the new lot and rerun it without changing the reagents. If the results are as expected, that is, the positive QC is giving us a positive result, the negative QC is giving us a negative result, the problem is most likely with the original batch of new lot QC. If the results are unexpected, we would rerun both fresh and old batch of QC with the fresh reagents. If the results are as expected, the problem is most likely with the old reagent. So if the results are still unexpected, that is, even this fresh batch of QC is still not giving us positive results with a positive control, negative results with a negative control, this could indicate a problem with the entire QC lot, or it could indicate a problem with the instrumentation itself. So in the next slide, we will briefly review important concepts in qualitative QC, but there's the most important concept to keep in mind, which also obviously applies to quantitative procedures, is that it is imperative that patient test results are verified to be in control before they are reported. If QC results are not what they're expected to be, patient results should not be reported until the investigation is completed and corrective action, if needed, is done. So these concepts are components of an effective QMS and that intersect basically with qualitative QC. And some of these concepts have been or will be reviewed in other modules throughout this course. So the first important concept relates to sample management, which is obviously important in all lab testing, but maybe particularly relevant for qualitative microbiological testing. For example, testing that depends on the presence of a viable organism in the sample. The sample may need closer monitoring and better communication with the non-lab staff. Also important is the availability of dedicated professional staff who understand the principles of QC. Many qualitative QC procedures rely on the operator's technical and interpretive skills. This can be crucial in microscopic examinations, as we will see in the case reviews. Under equipment maintenance, we think of incubators, refrigerators, microscopes, autoclaves. For the control materials, we think of positive and negative controls that are used to monitor the effectiveness of test procedures that use special stains or reagents. For some tests with endpoints like agglutination, we also think of weak positive controls that should be included. The reagents obviously should be stored according to the manufacturer's instructions, labeled with the date they're opened and put into use, discarded at the appropriate expiration dates. And critical to all of this, obviously, is keeping records of all quality control processes and corrective actions. And this is necessary for continual improvement of the lab quality system. And again, some of these concepts will be or already have been visited in other modules. So we go to the second question now. Your lab, just a refresher of the scenario, we performed testing on 20 patient samples for hepatitis B core antibody. The QC included in the run came from a new lot number, and all of the patient samples and the positive QC were negative. So the second question is, what should you or could you have done to make it easier to find out the cause of the problem? And again, we have 1 minute. All right, so qualitative and semi-quantitative tests can utilize a variety of control materials. And what we're gonna discuss in this lecture are built-in controls, sometimes referred to by the manufacturers as onboard or procedural controls. We're gonna talk a little bit about traditional controls that mimic patient samples. And also in particular to the microbiology lab, we're gonna talk about stock cultures for use with microbiological examinations. So what are built-in controls? Built-in controls are those that are integrated into the design of a test system, such as a test kit device, for example, a pregnancy test. Usually the device is marked with a designated area where there's a colored line, a bar, or a dot that appears to indicate the success or the failure of a positive, failure of positive and negative controls. These controls are performed automatically with each test. It's very important to keep in mind that built-in controls monitor only a portion of the examination phase, and they vary from one test to another as to what is being monitored. For example, built-in controls for some kits may indicate that all the reagents impregnated into the device are active and working properly, whereas built-in controls for other kits may only indicate that a sample was added and solutions flowed through the device correctly. So it's important to read the instructions provided by the manufacturer to understand what the built-in controls are monitoring and to determine what additional controls are needed. Examples of test kits with built-in controls are rapid tests that detect presence of antigens or antibodies, such as those we utilize in infectious diseases diagnoses, drugs of abuse testing, pregnancy testing, fecal occult blood. Even though these built-in controls give some degree of confidence, again, since they do not monitor for all conditions that could affect the examination phase of testing, it is advisable to periodically test traditional control materials that mimic patient samples for the added confidence in the accuracy and reliability of test results. Before we go to traditional controls, we're going to review question 2 in our scenario. So the question was, what should we have done to make it easier to find out the cause of the problem? The answer is that every time we have a new lot QC, it is important to verify its performance against the old lot QC. So including the old lot QC with the new lot QC in the testing, since we're familiar with how the old LUT performs, would verify the performance of both negative and of both positive and negative new LUT QC. For example, if the old LUT QC gave us a positive result as expected, we would have been able to tell relatively immediately that the new the particular batch of the new LUT QC was problematic, instead of having to investigate. So we were talking about built-in controls. We're going to move to traditional controls now. Traditional control materials, as we said, are made to mimic patient samples. They're tested with the patient samples in the same manner to evaluate the examination component of the testing process. Ideally, controls, these controls should have the same composition or what we refer to as the matrix as patient samples. This includes viscosity, turbidity, color, in order to properly evaluate the test performance. Control materials are often lyophilized when received and need to be carefully reconstituted before use. So we can think of errors that could arise because of improper reconstitution in this scenario. Some manufacturers may provide these controls with the test kits, but more frequently they need to be purchased separately. Traditional controls would evaluate the examination phase or the examination part of the testing process more broadly than built-in controls. They would assess the integrity of the testing system. For example, they pick up on instrument failures, inadequate maintenance. They test the reagents. For example, if there's a problem, if the reagents are not performing as expected because of problems with shipping, problems with storage, problems with preparation, they've been expired and not discarded. They also assess performance in a way, operator performance, and this is an indirect assessment of their training and or competency. They also evaluate the suitability of the physical testing environment. We're thinking of temperatures, changes in humidity. More on these traditional controls. So what are we thinking of when we think of traditional controls in terms of qualitative or semi-quantitative testing? We think of positive, weak positive as relevant, for example, for tests that involve agglutination, and negative controls should be used. Ideally, the positive and negative controls should be close to the cutoff. And for those assays that include an extraction process, controls that are capable of detecting errors in that step should be included as well. These controls should be run in the same manner as patient specimens, preferably with each run. Frequency is each day of testing, or at least per manufacturer's recommendation. In addition to these routine requirements, we should run QC to validate new lots of reagents or kits or calibrators after maintenance procedures, when there are new personnel in the lab that have been trained on the procedure, when there has been a major change in the testing procedure itself. We go back to our scenario. Again, 20 patient results with the positive control gave negative results on hepatitis B core antibody. The third question is, what do you do about reporting patients' results? Okay, so we've talked about built-in and traditional controls. Now we're going to talk about a specific type of control that's relevant to the microbiology lab, which is stock cultures of organisms with predictable reactions that verify stains, reagents, media are working correctly. These cultures are available as reference strains that are available basically commercially, or they're developed in-house. In any case, they should be kept on hand, carefully maintained in the form of stock and working cultures. And for each reaction that is expected, organisms that would give positive or negative results should be tested. The following organizations offer reference strains which are available from local distributors: the American Type Culture Collection in the US, the National Type Culture Collection in the UK, and the Pasteur Institute Collection in France. Purchased reference strains are usually lyophilized and kept refrigerated. Once they're reconstituted, plated, and checked for purity, they can be used to make working cultures for quality control. And as mentioned in the previous slide, some labs may choose to use their own isolates for QC. If so, they should be monitored closely to verify that reactions tested are sustained over time. One application of stock cultures is in the QC of stains used in the lab, and we're going to talk about that shortly. But before we move to this topic, let's go back to question three in our scenario. So what do we do about reporting patients' results? Obviously, this will ultimately depend on our investigation, but the first thing to note based on what we've discussed so far is that these patients' results should not be reported until the investigation is completed. So if the problem was with the batch of the new lot QC, and the system is verified to be in control by using a fresh batch of QC that gave us the expected patient results, then patient results can be reported. Okay, the error was in the QC. If the problem was with the reagent and or system, then patient results should be repeated after correction of the problem, either troubleshooting what's going on with the instrument or changing the reagents. And then also making sure that the controls used in this new testing process are behaving as expected, and then the patient results can be reported. Moving on to stains. So some stains can be purchased commercially, but others may be prepared by the lab following an established procedure. Once stains are made, their bottles should be labeled with the following information: name of the stain, concentration, date prepared, date placed in service, expiration date or shelf life, preparer's initials. It is useful to keep a logbook for recording information on each stain in use, including the lot number and date received for the commercial stains. They should be stored at the correct temperature at all times and in the appropriate staining bottle. Some stains must be protected from light. In some cases, working solutions can be made from stock solutions, but again, the same principles apply. The storage of working solutions should be carefully monitored. Because of their importance, stains should be examined for precipitation or crystal formation, for bacterial or other obvious contamination before each use. In addition, they should be checked each day of use with positive and negative QC materials, ideally, to make sure that the reagents are active and that they provide the intended results. In most cases, positive and negative controls should be stained with each batch of patients' slides. I say in most cases, and I say ideally, but please note that this does not necessarily happen routinely. All quality control results must be recorded each time that they are run. Again, careful maintenance of and care of the stock and working solutions of stains is an essential component in a quality system to continue to provide good quality in microscopic examinations. Also, we need to be aware that many stains are toxic, therefore appropriate safety precautions should be taken when working with these stains. This is an example of a gram stain QC slide with gram positive and gram negative organisms. These slides can be commercially available. Typically, they contain two circles of heat fixed suspensions of a gram positive organism, usually Staphylococcus aureus, and gram negative organism, usually E. coli. But they can also be prepared in house using the stock cultures that we discussed previously. This is another example of a gram stain QC slide. On the right side, we see gram positive staining where we would expect to see gram negative organisms. So what is going on here? So there could be many possibilities, but one that would first come to mind is an inappropriate staining technique, specifically under decolorization with a decolorizing agent. And this gives rise to the gram-negative organisms retaining the stain and appearing as gram-positive organisms. In this case, if QC was not used and the same error was present in the other patient slides, this might not have been picked and the organism could have been misclassified. All right, so we come to our last question for this scenario. How would we know if patient samples from the previous day were accurate? So we talked about how we identify the error, whether it's QC or the system, how we could have identified that sooner, what should we do about patient results that were tested on that day? And this question is about how do we know if the patient samples from the previous day were accurate? And now we move to the last section of this talk, which is QC of microbiology, media and microbiology. So the quality of the media used in the microbiology lab is crucial, obviously, to achieving optimal and reliable results. They're essential to isolation of microbes, so it is imperative that they function as expected. And there are quality control procedures in place that provide the confidence that media have not been contaminated prior to use, that they support the growth of the organisms with which they were inoculated, and the biochemical reactions expected are taking place. For media that's prepared in-house, this evaluation should be conducted for each batch prepared. For all commercially prepared media, the performance verification should be performed for each new lot number. So it's helpful to think of media QC requirements in the following manner. There's visual inspection, there's testing for contamination, and there's testing with the reference QC organisms. So here I want to mention that different regulatory bodies might have different requirements depending on the types of media used. So for example, in the United States, there are media that are considered exempt. This would include commercial media that have demonstrated consistent user performance with minimum variation. An example would be actually the McConkie agar. So QC requirements for exempt media are less stringent, may include visual inspection only. But the lab may choose to perform more stringent QC for these media. The point is, whatever is in the SOP for media QC should be followed by all operators, regardless of whether this media is considered exempt or not. And again, this depends on different on the regulatory bodies in different countries. So it's not a uniform practice. So here visual inspection and contamination. Before checking the ability of media to support growth and yield the appropriate biochemical reactions as applicable, they should be checked for the following problems when received or when prepared: a cracked or damaged plate, detached agar, frozen, melted agar, unequal or insufficient filling, hemolysis of blood-containing media, color changes, excessive bubbles, excessive moisture or dryness, obvious precipitates, obvious contamination. And then decisions should be made on whether only the plate should be discarded or the entire lot should be discarded. Sterility testing usually is performed by incubating the media overnight before use. It's important to note that for media prepared in-house, sheep and horse blood are preferred for routine cultures. Blood agar made from human blood should not be used, as it will not demonstrate the correct hemolysis pattern for identification of certain organisms. It may contain inhibitory substances, and obviously it is biohazardous. So the third step is the media QC. In media QC is the verification of performance using the QC, the reference QC organisms we've talked about. The lab should maintain specific and sufficient stock cultures to check all its media and test systems. For example, E. coli for McConkie, agar, Staphylococcus aureus for blood agar, Neisseria gonorrhea for chocolate agar. For selective media, control organisms should include both those that can grow and those that are inhibited. For differential media, the control organisms should additionally include those that demonstrate different expected reactions. For example, on McConkie agar, we should inoculate both lactose fermenting and non-lactose fermenting organisms to verify that the colonies exhibit the correct visual appearance. And needless to say, discard any batch of media that does not work as expected. It's important to keep careful records for all of the media that is prepared in the lab or commercially available. A logbook should be maintained that could record examples, name of the media, date and preparer's name for in-house media, lot number and manufacturer for commercial media, number of prepared plates, tubes, bottles of flask, color, consistency, appearance, number of plates used for QC, sterility test results, pH, and others. One helpful way of tagging this process is that so that operators know which media and or reagents are available for use is to color code them while they're in storage. For example, here, the pink stickers indicate that this has been received, these reagents or media they've been received, but no QC has been performed. The blue sticker indicate that QC is in progress, and then the green stickers indicate that these reagents and or media are ready for use, so that operators coming into the storage area can pick them up and use them for patient samples. And now back to our final question in the hepatitis B core antibody scenario. How can we tell if patients' results from the previous day were in control? So again, this depends on the results of our investigation. If the problem was with a new lot QC, then patient results from yesterday were likely accurate. If the problem was with the testing kit sometimes it may be difficult to determine. Although unlikely, it is possible that the error in the testing kit affected patient results but did not affect QC on the previous day, and that it was only picked up by the QC on the day of testing we're talking about. For those reasons, it's really important to keep patient samples for some time in the lab before they're discarded in order to allow for retesting if needed. Very important to keep in mind that records should be kept of all controls and test kits that are run with patient samples. Lot numbers, expiration dates should be recorded in case problems arise, and previous results need to be repeated. So in summary, qualitative tests and semi-quantitative tests are frequently used in the lab. They do not report numerical results, but may, in the case of semi-quantitative testing, give an estimate of quantity or concentration. These tests must be monitored by QC material that ideally mimics patient specimens and that would allow to ensure that there hasn't been a change in the performance of kits, reagents, stains, or microbiological media. The lab must establish a qualitative QC program that ensures that policies are followed by operators and that includes maintenance and review of QC records. The key messages to remember is that QC procedures must be followed by all staff, QC results and corrective actions recorded, and that when QC results are not acceptable, patient results are not reported until investigation and corrective action, if needed, are performed. Thank you, and now we move to questions.
Hi, Roa. Thanks for that presentation. We actually only have one question so far, and it okay. is, in case you don't have access to ATCC organisms for controls, how can you go about preparing in-house controls, and what documentation is needed to be in place to show for these in-house controls?
So I'm not a microbiologist by training, and so I'm not familiar with that process beyond what I've discussed in that lecture. But that information can be easily obtained, and I can email it to the group. My understanding is that if you grow the organism in the lab, then from a patient specimen, say you can basically subculture it, and then use that culture as your own stock culture. You just have to maintain. You just have to make sure that, in a similar manner to a reference organism, this isolate is performing as expected.
All right, thank you. I think then I guess we can go on to the case study.
Okay, so let me. So I should stop sharing this one and then share my case studies, I guess. Okay.
That's right.
All right, let me.
We actually have a couple more questions. I'm sorry.
Oh yeah, sure. But also before that, I just wanted to know how the case reviews how has it been going? Like, how do people interact? Do I get to see people's responses? My understanding is that this is not a lecture, so it's more interactive. How are we going to go about that?
I think me and Emily will be reading questions to you for discussion.
Okay.
Emily, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, I think in the sessions before, the lecturer has just kind of walked through the case. So walk through the question and then kind of walk through how they would work through the case.
Okay. So we had questions?
We did. We had a couple more come in. Emily, would you like to go through these?
Sure. So the first question is, can you give out results without running control on that particular day?
So that's a good question. And the answer to that obviously depends on the test itself, right? And depends on the procedure. So my understanding, for example, as in the lab that I oversee, for example, we do serum protein electrophoresis, immunofixation electrophoresis. For those, every time we run patient specimens, there is a control that is run, and this is another example of qualitative testing, right? So there's always a control that is run, and if it's not behaving as expectedly, then the gel is repeated, or QC, the troubleshooting is performed as specified in the procedure. For tests that are semi-quantitative, again, in cases of serology, these controls are always run. For example, we do serology right now for anti-SARS-CoV-2 every time, and those are qualitative. We report them as reactive and non-reactive. Every time, every day, we run these patient tests, we run the control. I was talking with my colleague in the microbiology lab about Gram stains, for example, and he said for Gram stains, they run them once a week, the controls. And we're gonna talk a little bit more about Gram stains in the case review about what is the information that a Gram stain QC slide is capable of giving, and what are its limitations, or what are issues that might not be uncovered by a Gram stain QC. So the answer is variable. It also depends on regulations. There are certain tests for which you have to have a minimum amount of controls done at a certain frequency. And there are ones that the lab decides on the frequency. No matter what the decision is, whatever is in your SOP has to be followed. But what definitely is a definitive answer is if your control is not behaving as expectedly, then you should not give out results on that particular day.
Okay, thanks, Roa. We have actually several more questions that came through. Yeah. So the next one is, would you please shed more light on expiration dates for the ATCC organisms? Does the expiration date on the certificate still hold if you have already cultured the organism and are maintaining them by subculturing?
Again, this is a question that I can get information to. I do not have specific information available to me about that, but that's something easily obtained. I can discuss with my microbiology colleagues to see what their practice is, because here in the lab, we definitely have both options, the commercially available organisms and the ones that have been isolated or subbed in the lab. And then I see a question that says, what can be done when you release results before reviewing the control results? In our procedure, for example, in our own lab, this would be considered an error, because you're required to review control results before you release patient results. But it doesn't mean that it doesn't happen. It does happen, and sometimes it happens again on during, for example, night shifts when this is universal probably in most labs, when you have less staff. So they could be overwhelmed, and sometimes results are released before properly reviewing the control results, or even incorrectly reviewing them. In that case, it depends. Again, we're going to talk about it in the Gram stain. Some labs for certain assays might have particular procedures whereby there's a secondary review, depending on the assay. This could be problematic logistically. And then if it's picked up on the second review, then basically a corrective a report is made. Sometimes what happens is that if the results are clinically discrepant, you get a call from the provider asking you what is going on. We were not expecting this result. How did this happen? And then you do a review and you realize that that there was an error. Unfortunately, there are probably many occasions where this is going to be missed. And it does not necessarily mean that the patient's results were erroneous. It just means that we will not be able to determine whether they were indeed correct or not.
Great, thank you. And then the next one is an AP question. So in the anatomic pathology lab, for immunohistochemistry testing, if you get negative positive control QC and a test becomes positive on the bat, should this result be reported?
What are your thoughts, Emily?
I can take that one. So I think it would, it sort of depends. So if, you know, if you're running a pancytic keratin and you have, and the epithelium is clearly strongly positive, I think you could resources are limited. Maybe you could make the argument that that is like an on-slide positive. I tend to be pretty hesitant to result IHC if the positive control didn't work. I'm a hematopathologist, so I have no way of knowing, if the correct antibody was, no way of guaranteeing if the correct antibody was run. And sometimes it's hard to tell in the tissue, if you have a lymphoma and you ran a CD20 and the onside control didn't work, is the reactivity you're seeing really truly CD20 or is it something else because they added the wrong antibody? So I would be pretty hesitant to run it, but I think there are some situations where maybe you could make the argument that it's reacting as you would expect. So hopefully that's helpful.
Thank you.
Sorry, next question. Do you have anything to add, Roa?
No, I think that's what I was thinking precisely. Sometimes in cases of irretrievable specimens, and again, it depends on if this result is actionable, whether it's going to lead to a medical decision point. I mean, all of these have to be taken into consideration, right? Like this is a very precious specimen. We're not going to be able to get another one. What do we do? But at the same time, if the decision based on your result is going to lead to action with the patient. So all of these need to be thought of there's not always the same consistent answer, although generally we err on the side of if the control tells you that this didn't work, then probably it didn't work.
Yeah, that's a great point. That's a really good point. Yeah, it's definitely something to consider the irreplaceability of the specimen and whether clinical action will be taken.
Then I see carry over samples in place of controls. My understanding of this question is that basically your own patient specimens. Certainly there are, I'll give an example again, that's very relevant to COVID. When we first started offering the serology test, there were still no QC available by either the company Roche that was offering the test or even other third-party vendors. So the way we had to find controls was to pool patient sera that tested positive and use those as our positive QC. And again, negative QC is generally easier to obtain. So but what is very important to remember is that once you identify your patient, a patient specimen or an alternate, like a non-commercial specimen as your QC, the same rules would apply to your QC if it's quantitative or qualitative, the way it should be monitored, stored, recorded, reviewed, all of that needs to be kept in mind. With commercial QC, we know their expiration date. With patient specimens, you might want to think about stability. And sometimes we know that because of previous studies that we've done. Sometimes we don't. We just have to keep on testing it periodically to make sure that it's still giving us the result that it's supposed to give. And again, the lab a priori would decide what those criteria are and when to discard a patient specimen, whether you're going to wait until it turns, if it's positive, you're going to wait until it turns negative, or you go by specific dates. You say, we're just going to use this over the next month, for example, and then we're going to get a fresh one. Those are decisions that the lab would make. And for LJ plots, those are specifically for statistical tools in order to follow on quantitative results, where there's no mean standard deviation in qualitative QC. So there's no role for the LJ chart in monitoring qualitative analysis. And I think the previous question about carryover specimens also answers the urine and stool for routine testing. Depending on the specific test, you can utilize patient specimens that have been positive. For the special blood agar, if there's no sheep, the recommendation was for horse blood, but I would imagine that that's also potentially not available. That's something that I can look into. I do not have an answer for right now.
And I can take the last one, Roa.
Okay.
So the last question is, could you comment on controls and interpretation of immunohistochemistry, for example, in breast cancer, where in some cases the preservation of the tissue may not be optimal? I totally understand. This is a real concern in some areas where, you know, access to appropriately buffered formalin, tissue fixation times aren't necessarily controlled very well. I think that's why having an on-site control is really important. But I think that it is also important to take into consideration those pre-analytical factors when you interpret your immunohistochemistry. So is it, if you're getting a negative ER, is it truly negative, or is it because the tissue wasn't fixed properly? I think this goes back to the lecture from last week where, I think it's really important to educate our clinical colleagues about appropriate pre-analytical concerns. And so, giving them the educational resources to know how to fix the tissue properly, how much time the tissue needs to be fixed, where to access the appropriate formalin, things like that. Did you have anything to add, Roa?
No.
All right, so, I think that's it for the questions. Did you want to move? Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, no, I was going to say I'll move forward, but I'll keep this window open so I can see. So this is where participants would put in their because I'm curious to find out how people have thought about these cases before we go over them. And so I'll see that in the Q&A.
In the past, the panelists have, or the lecturers have just gone through that process. The audience hasn't participated.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
So it'll be in the form of questions, I suppose.
Yeah. So if okay. So as you go through the case, and answer the question and kind of go through how you would work through it, but the audience hasn't necessarily typed their answers into the chat. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Okay. So all right. So we'll go through that now. All right. So we have three cases. I need to remove the Q&A. It's still interesting. Okay. So we had a 54-year-old man with a CD4 count of 9, watery diarrhea for the past 1 month, and weight loss with no symptoms of cryptococcal disease. A serum cryptococcal antigen screen was positive. At your institution, it is the case here, for example, at our institution, a positive cryptococcal antigen test is reflexed to cryptococcal antigen latex agglutination in order to obtain titers. And so we had a schematic representation of the QC and patient results, and the questions were, is this out of control, and describe additional steps to be made. All right. So I'm gonna go over the schematic representation here. For the positive control, we had negative in both the detection latex and the control latex. For the antibody control, which is usually only applied to the control latex, we got a positive reaction. For the negative control, we got a positive reaction in the detection latex, a negative reaction in the control latex, and we had a patient specimen that gave us a positive reaction in the detection latex and a negative reaction in the control latex. And before we go over how we would we further interpret this, the first thing that I would say is that the patient specimen at least is expected because the cryptococcal antigen test was positive. So we have the correct result right here as expected. So what is a detection latex and what are the control latex? We'll go over these again, I think, in another slide, but we can briefly discuss the legend. So what a detection latex is basically where the site of your test. It is standardized latex particles that are coated with anti-cryptococcal globulin. So basically, if the patient specimen has cryptococcal antigen, it will give a positive result. It will agglutinate with the detection latex. The control latex is standardized latex particles with normal rat globulin. The antibody control contains anti-rabbit serum. The positive control contains Cryptococcus neoformans antigen, and the negative control contains normal human serum. So what is the cryptococcal antigen latex agglutination test? Let's go over that before we do our interpretation. It's a semi-quantitative test for the detection of capsular polysaccharide antigens of the Cryptococcus neoformans that can be used in serum or CSF. As we mentioned in the previous slide, it utilizes latex particles that are coated with the anti-cryptococcal globulin, which we call the detection latex. And the detection latex reacts with the antigen if it's present in a specimen to form visible agglutination. And that agglutination can be quantified from 1+ to 2+, 3+, 4+. Latex particles, again, this is an example of a semi-quantitative test. But we also have a control latex because sometimes there are non-specific interferences or non-specific antibodies in the patient's serum, more likely than in the patient's CSF, that would react with the detection latex, but they're not necessarily cryptococcal antigen. So it's non-specific agglutination, and we need to have a control for that. And that control is what we call the control latex. So this is just normal globulin. And if there's any antibody present the idea is that if there's non-specific interference, it should affect the detection latex and the control latex similarly. So we have that as a control. The negative control consists of normal human serum, and that should not cause agglutination in either the detection latex or the control latex. I didn't include this here, but we can talk about it briefly. So what is the antibody control? The antibody control is designed to make sure that the control latex is working because it specifically reacts with this globulin. So the latex particles in the control latex are rabbit globulin, and the antibody would contain anti-rabbit globulin. So this is called an antibody control. And then the positive control would be a suspension of cryptococcal antigen. So it should give us a positive reaction in the detection latex, but a negative reaction in the control latex. I'm sharing here a screenshot of the cryptococcal antigen latex agglutination system, the SOP that we have in the lab. This is an example of what a typical SOP would look like, an introduction to what the test system is. We go over safety precautions, procedural precautions. Then you define what the specimens are that are acceptable, the frequency of testing. I highlighted in yellow the areas of the SOP that relate to quant control. So you have a section on quality control, which is how to perform it, what is out of control, define what is an out of control situation, and what you should do in that case. And again, there's your typical SOP that would include what are the reagents, the supplies and the equipment, how you prepare the reagents, how you prepare the specimen. Then there are descriptions of the procedure itself. How would you interpret and analyze results? How would you report them? Okay, so here's what we should see. And this is what we've discussed in the previous slide, right? We know that the positive control contains cryptococcal antigen, so it should be positive, but not in the control latex because it does not contain an anti-rabbit antibody. The antibody control contains an anti-rabbit serum, so it should be positive here. There's no reason to apply it to the detection latex. And the negative control, which is normal human serum, and usually you heat inactivate it just to make sure that there's not going to be any nonspecific interference, is giving us appropriately negative in both. And then there's the patient specimen. So what we got was the following. Clearly, this was not the expected result. I could speculate that what had happened here is simply a switch. Someone, the operator switched the negative, applied the negative control in the positive control lane. Basically switched the specimens. It could be that the positive control was accidentally heat inactivated. You really don't want to heat inactivate the positive control because again, whatever, then you won't get the reaction. You really should only activate the negative control, okay? Just because, so, again, if this is CSF, this goes back to our questions which we discussed earlier about irretrievable specimens, in the sense that should we report this patient specimen? Let's say we don't have any more CSF, and it does reflect the clinical picture. That's a different story than if the patient, then this is an unknown specimen, we don't know what's the expectation, and then we got this result. So again, those are cases where the investigation could take multiple pathways. Here's what we have as a quality control policy in the lab. So what is mentioned is that the kit components should be visually examined for obvious signs of microbial contamination, freezing or leakage. Latex controls must be performed on each assay run in parallel with patient specimens, and the QC results should be recorded. This is a clear example where you cannot run your test without a QC, okay? So what do you do with out of control results? Whenever a control is out of range, the patient samples on that run are repeated. Okay, so the first thing that you do, you repeat the patient specimen, but when you repeat the patient samples, it means you repeat the entire, like you repeat whatever's on the card, like including the antibodies that were utilized. And no results are reported until the control is within the acceptable range. Sometimes basically you just stop at that step because on repeat, whatever the error was, if it was a human error, would have been maybe fixed, and then your controls are acceptable, so you report the patient result. So if this is not the case, you review the procedure, and you make sure that you're following the steps, and you're using the appropriate controls, and you're using them or preparing them appropriately. You verify that you're not using anything that has expired. This is just repeating what we said. You repeat QC and any necessary unnecessary patient tests. If the repeat control test is acceptable, no further action is required. What we say here is that if the repeat QC fails, then the technologist who's performing the assay should consult the supervisor and in order to determine further corrective action, because then this is where we go into potentially like a lot of reagents or a lot of controls is malfunctioning, and what do we need to do about that? So there's not always the same answer to how to go about it all the time. But what I found helpful, because sometimes QC situations, whether they're quantitative or qualitative, can become frustrating in the sense that they tend to appear at first mysterious, like what is going on? What is going on is has to be one of three things, basically. Either the person is not performing the procedure correctly, either it's a problem with the control, or it's a problem with the reagent. By reagent, I also mean test system. It has to be one of those three. It cannot be something mysterious. So So going after each variable usually helps. And the first thing we do is repeating just to make sure that it wasn't a random error or a random switch, like we said. And then if that doesn't resolve the issue, then we start replacing. We start basically replacing with new controls. That doesn't work, we try with new reagents. Okay, and if the new reagent, again, if either of these steps don't work, then we start thinking of changing the lot. Okay, and then the last step, usually in this case it might not particularly apply, but in our case the last step, when you've done everything and nothing basically is working, you call the company and tell them what is going on here, so that they come and figure out if there's an error with the instrumentation itself. Okay, very important. Any out of control result that is recognized, along with the actions taken and the final resolution, should be documented and reported in the troubleshooting log. So there's a cryptococcal latex troubleshooting log that's kept in the lab, and this is where this information is recorded. Okay. So we could have questions now about this case, or we could proceed with the second case, but I don't see any questions. So I'm gonna proceed with the second case and then the third case, and then we can review everything if that's okay with everyone. All right, so there was the second case was a batch of McConkey agar was made and poured into individual plates. List the steps that need to be performed before this medium can be used for patient testing. All right, so the first thing, this is a review of the previous lecture basically, is we check for appearance. After this media is prepared, poured, solidified, we go and take a look. Again, we check for the things we talked about previously. Are the plates cracked or damaged? Has the agar detached? Are there, is there unequal or insufficient filling? If this, the hemolysis is not a consideration here, but are there color changes that are not expected? Do we see excessive bubbles, excessive moisture or dryness? Do we see visible precipitates or obvious contamination? So once we do that, we incubate one uninoculated plate overnight in order to check for purity, make sure that it is sterile. And then we've done our visual inspection, we've done our contamination test. Now we need to see if this media is performing as expected. So we can use, we inoculate one plate, but we can use half a plate for the following. So we, in this case, we would use the following control organisms: E. coli, which is a lactose fermenter, and Pseudomonas, which is a non-lactose fermenter. So E. coli will should give us colonies that turn purplish. With Pseudomonas, the colonies should be clear. So in this case, we're checking that the agar is capable, that McConkey agar is allowing these two organisms to grow as expected and also to give us the expected biochemical reactions. But we also need a negative control. And so we would inoculate another plate with Staph epidermidis, for example, and incubate. No growth should occur on this plate because McConkey does not support its growth. And we don't have to do these sequentially. They can be done simultaneously, but they all must be done, completed, and recorded before using the media, and then written down in a media QC logbook. So I sent this example and we talked about it, and it could apply to your lab. But as I said, in the US, there are regulations that allow for less stringent QC procedures. McConkey agar is one of them. For example, here in the lab, there's only visual inspection when we receive, because they're commercially available to us. So when the plates arrive, they're visually inspected. And then again, there's a procedure in place to decide what to do when you see. So are you going to discard just one plate, or are you going to discard the entire box? My understanding, for example, is if you see mold, which can go everywhere, is if you see mold on one plate, you tend to discard the entire box. If it's just like a single colony on one plate, you might just discard the plate. There is room for judgment, but most of this is written very clearly in an SOP. Okay, and then there is the test for sterility, so they're incubated overnight before use. But the QC, the reference QC organisms are not used. They're not used for McConkey. They're used for other agars that are classified as non-exempt. And the reason why this classification occurs is, again, there's a regulatory body in the States, the CAP, the College of American Pathologists. What they do is that they monitor the performance over time of these media based on the users, and they notice that there's very minimum variation for some of these media. In other words, what the manufacturers are doing is as best as it could be. So there's no need to go consistently. These media are performing as expected. For others, there are more lot-to-lot variations that basically mean that the lab should actually verify this performance. Okay, so here we come to the last case, which is a case of mistaken identity. And I think it's the kind of the most complicated one in among these cases. So this is a 4-year-old female patient that's brought to the emergency department with complaints of fever, headache, vomiting, and drowsiness. A lumbar puncture was performed and CSF was sent to the lab for analysis, which revealed pleocytosis, elevated protein, and low glucose. Gram stain showed gram-negative diplococci, and a rapid diagnostic test was positive for Streptococcus pneumoniae. These results were immediately reported to the ED, and the treating physician was confused by the findings and called the lab to speak to the supervisor. So the questions were, what is the source of the confusion? How would we investigate, and could we, or how could we have prevented this? All right, so interpretation of gram stains for the non-microbiologist are basically notoriously difficult, especially for the generalist. This is an article that attempted to provide some objective guidelines. Before we go into this, what is the situation that we're talking about here? We're talking about a rapid antigen test that identified Streptococcus pneumoniae, which is gram positive. And then the preliminary gram stain report, the gram stain identified gram negative diplococci, and this was released to the physician. So this is the discrepancy and the source of confusion, right? The gram stain report said that there were gram negative diplococci, but the RDT showed a Streptococcus pneumoniae. And both Streptococcus and what we're thinking of here in terms of negative diplococci, which is Neisseria, both are known pathogens of that cause meningitis, which is the working diagnosis here. So what happened, and in this case is a discussion of what could have happened, could this have been prevented, and what are the control mechanisms that could be put in place to avoid this. So from a visual perspective, in addition to the fact that Streptococcus is gram positive, Streptococcus should appear as lancet shaped pointed ends, diplococci, if you see here in the pointed arrows. And there's a capsule that's visible as a halo around the bacteria, providing another clue that this is strep pneumo. On the other hand, the Neisseria species, which we see here, appear as gram negative, obviously, but then they have a kidney bean or biscuit shaped ends. Okay, so believe me, as a non-microbiologist, this lancet shaped versus kidney beans is something that is very confusing to me. So this is why the generalist, the laboratorian who is not a microbiologist, who hasn't done gram stains over and over the years, would find difficulty in making these interpretations, because in general, we go by this is gram positive, this is gram negative. So it is not This is something that requires a seasoned tech, someone who's very experienced and who's been doing this for a long time. Okay, so what could go wrong with this process? So human interpretive error, this is the first thing that we could think of. What you're seeing is not actually what's on the slide. Sometimes staining properties of certain bacteria, which sometimes we refer to as gram variable, could contribute to this, and meaning that the bacteria that should be gram positive might look gram negative, and gram negative bacteria that should be gram negative might retain the crystal violet stain, so they would appear gram positive. And this is related to cell wall properties, to sometimes how old the specimen is. So there are multiple variables that would that could cause this, but they tend to occur with specific bacteria, which we will talk about in a little bit. There are also technical considerations in how you're doing the gram stain itself. You're either under decolorizing, for example, or over decolorizing. So if you under decolorize, basically your gram negative bacteria may falsely appear as gram positive because they've retained the stain. You did not decolorize the stain. If you over decolorize, gram positive bacteria now will falsely appear as gram negative, and this is the case here. Okay, so there was an over decolorization step, so the stain was removed, and this could happen universally, but it also tends to happen with specific. So under decolorization and over decolorization also tends to happen with particular bacteria that are more amenable to these staining patterns. What is another source of error? Is the failure to examine an adequate number of fields in your gram stain. So what is very important to know, and this is when we're gonna talk about the limitations of the slide QC, is that even in a well-performed stain, in a thick smear, you're gonna have areas that are under decolorized or over decolorized. So it's very important to look at different fields and an adequate number of these fields in order to find an area that is stained appropriately. Sometimes there are debris and artifacts that mimic organisms. And in this case, they can either get be called as organisms or alternatively, because someone's aware of the fact of debris and artifacts, it could be an organism that's present that is erroneously thought of as an artifact. Okay, so we talked about gram variable organisms that take up the positive or the crystal violet stain variably. So for example, here we have the bacillus species. So this is one known offender. They can look gram variable or even frankly gram negative. I mean, if someone were to call this a gram negative rod, I would not be, I mean, we see some of the crystal here, but I wouldn't think of this as a faulty interpretation. They do look gram negative, and these are gram positive rods, okay? Interestingly, actually, with the bacillus species, when these organisms are grown directly from patient specimens, they tend to display these variable patterns. When they're grown in the lab and then stained, they are strongly positive. Alternatively, there are instances of classically gram-negative organisms, such as Acinetobacter, which you see here on the right side, and this bacteria here, it retained the crystal violet stain and it appears strongly gram-positive. So someone would have called this gram-positive when this is a gram, but the culture is going to give us a gram-negative bacteria. All right, so how can QC help in this case? It's really important to know that gram stain QC slides are only a small component of gram stain quality assurance. If the QC slide that was performed shows over decolorization or under decolorization, then this is easy because you've identified the problem. In this case, if the concomitant QC slide was over decolorized, you can say so there were multiple errors in this case. First of all, that the person did not review the QC slide if it were over decolorized. Second, the person did not stop and think that a gram negative the report of a gram-negative stain is discrepant with the result of the RDT. So there were several errors in this case that had happened. But the QC slide might look normal, okay? Because this is something that, because this is something related to how the slide was read. Maybe this was an over-decolorized section of the slide and the technologist did not do an adequate review. So the QC slide, again, it's important to remember it is a small component of gram stain quality assurance in this case. What it can really help with is identify problems with reagents, okay, if they're expired, if they're not working, then the slide QC is ideal for this. They can also reveal technical competencies, not with interpretations, obviously, but for example, operator missing steps, not adhering to the SOP, not as trained, right? So if they consistently, their QC slide is not working, then this is someone who needs to be retrained. Okay, so what are our other quality assurance tools here in this case, since the slide QC is not going to be always helpful? So just remember that any and all QA tools should be specified in a procedure and they should be followed by staff training and assessment. So while reading the gram stain, what QA practices would be adequate examination of numerous representative fields at a minimum of 1 minute, longer for critical specimens such as CSF. Avoid areas that are over or under decolorized. For example, in under decolorized areas, you will see purple precipitates. The ability to recognize debris and artifacts that mimic organisms and make a distinction, basically. For example, let's say, we're concerned that this is an artifact, but the technologist wants to call it as an organism. If there's not more than one scene, there are several options here. Consider not reporting the result, consider obtaining consultation with another technologist, or reporting possible or probable bacteria. Again, all of these possibilities should be specified in a procedure so that people know what to do when they come across these situations. Here's another set of quality assurance tools before reporting results is a very important question to ask. Is this expected? Okay, as I'm reading the slide, is this expected? And this is where experience and proficient techs come in. And this is where generalists tend to struggle, is the knowledge of morphotypes that are expected from common site. And by morphotypes, we mean specific staining pattern with a specific shape, okay? Like a gram positive cocci, that's a morphotype. So the idea of, does this morphotype that we've looked at in this stain, does this make sense given the site? For example, let's say, you saw gram-negative coccobacilli that are suggestive of Haemophilus influenza and your specimen is a wound. That's not expected. So I would question this result and think, what else could it be, right? You could also have procedures in place to re-examine or consult with another technologist. For example, here, because the night shift techs are generalists, basically they're trained to cross-cover multiple sections of the lab, the core lab in chemistry and hematology and micro. And there's not a lot of gram stains that we receive. The volume is low enough that this could be done. The day shift techs would review the gram stains that have been read by the night shift tech. You could also do gram stain culture correlations. Obviously, there's going to be a lag here, but you could say we are going to have mechanisms in place to look at gram stain and culture, and if they don't correlate, to basically review the slide and either correct it or, there could be multiple options here, but that's an option. But again, this is not something that you should do. This is something that labs have adopted, and is very dependent on practicalities, logistics, and volume, obviously. Clearly, double review of specimens that meet specific criteria is one of them. It's actually not very clear if this has helped reduce error rates. And I'm curious if a similar, I know that similar practices have been adopted in areas of anatomic pathology. So I'm curious to see if there's data on whether this has reduced the error rates. Again, as we said, the logistics here might be challenging. So this is what I have for these case reviews. Hopefully this was helpful. I think one of the things to think of when reviewing these cases is that sometimes there are no easy and immediate answers, and they do require troubleshooting and investigation. It helps to think a priori of what possibly could go wrong and put that in an SOP. But there are cases where this is going to be an investigation, and the decisions that need to be made have not been spelled out in your SOP, and so consultation with a supervisor or a medical director is definitely needed in that case.
All right, thank you, Rava. We actually only have one question right now, and it's a specific question about, could you tell us about internal quality control for erythrocyte sedimentation rate?
So I'm not sure I understand this question, because there are several different methods for doing ESR, but what does it mean is that the built-in control that we're talking about, or are we talking about a patient specimen for ESR? There's not a specific at least as I'm looking at this question, there's not something specific for me about ESR that would not apply to other analytes, where you either have a control, a QC that's purchased from a vendor, or you have a patient that is you have patient specimens that have ESR is a quantitative analyte. So in this case, you would need either one patient or a pool of patient results that have a specific value that you monitor over time in order as QC, and you probably want to have multiple levels, at least two.
All right, thanks. Well, I don't see any other questions. So unless we get some comments on the case studies very soon, I think we can go ahead and wrap up for the day.
I guess there are no more questions.
No, I don't see any.
Okay, all right. Thank you, everyone. It's been a pleasure. And enjoy the rest of the modules in the course. And I'll look at some of the questions that were related to specifically stock organisms. I've recorded those, and I can have the answer sent to Dan, and we'll see how that could be disseminated to the rest of the participants. Thank you, and bye.
Thank you, Rob. Goodbye.
Bye.